Greetings. Today we will learn about sericulture, which is the combination of two words, sericos and culture, which sericos is a Greek word meaning silk and culture means to rear. Therefore, sericulture can be defined as a scientific method of rearing silkworms to procure silk. There is a very interesting story behind the discovery of silk. Tsai Ling Shi, wife of a great Chinese emperor, Huang Ti, accidentally dropped a cocoon of silkworms into the hot tea, which resulted in softening of the threads and which were recovered and weaved into threads. Therefore, these threads were named Tsai, S-I, in the honor of the empress. And empress was honored as Sian Than or deity of the silkworm. For the millennia, around three millennia, it was kept secret and only confined to China. But by 522 AD, sericulture reached westwards through smuggling by Persian monks. In 1905, Lefroy introduced sericulture for the first time in India at Pusa Institute. Sericulture is an agro-based export and labor-oriented cottage industry, which includes three main components: cultivation of food plants for the worms, then rearing of silkworm, and reeling and spinning. The first two are agricultural and the last one is an industrial component. Sericulture is of mainly two types, mulberry and non-mulberry sericulture, and India has both kinds of sericulture. So there are four kinds of silk produced in India, that is mulberry silk, tussar, muga and eri silk. Silkworms are moth belonging to order Lepidoptera and families Bombycidae and Saturninidae. First is mulberry silkworm, that is Bombyx murrayi, belonging to family Bombycidae, which has host plant as mulberry, and it produces reelable silk and white creamy cocoon, and is known to be domesticated in West Bengal, Karnataka, Andhra Pradesh, Tamil Nadu, Jammu and Kashmir, Himachal Pradesh and Uttaranchal. Next are non-mulberry silkworms belonging to family Saturninidae. Tussar silkworm, which is of two types, tropical silkworm, that is Anthraea mylita, and temperate silkworms, also called as oak tussar silkworm, that is Anthraea perniae or Anthraea proeli. The host plants of tropical tussar silkworm are Asan and Arjun, and it produces reelable silk from brown or coppery cocoon. It is known to be domesticated in Bihar, Orissa, Madhya Pradesh, Jharkhand, Chhattisgarh, West Bengal and Andhra Pradesh. The host plant of oak tussar silkworm is Quercus serrata and is known for producing finer variety of tussar silk, and it is domesticated in Manipur, Mizoram, Nagaland, Himachal Pradesh, Uttarakhand, Jammu and Kashmir and Meghalaya. Third is muga silkworm, Anthraea asamensis, which has soam and soalu as a host plant and produces reelable silk from golden yellow cocoon, and is domesticated in Assam, Meghalaya, Arunachal Pradesh, Mizoram and West Bengal. Next is eri silkworm, that is Philosomia or Attacus, and now it is known as Samia Cynthia Ricinae, which has castor as a host plant and produces reelable silk from red creamy, unreelable silk from red creamy white cocoon, and its producing states are Assam, Bihar, West Bengal, Manipur, Orissa, Nagaland and Andhra Pradesh. First, we will learn about the silk, which is also known as queen of textile, as it is well known for its natural glittering luster, a light weight and high tensile properties. It is produced from the silk gland, which is a modified salivary gland present in the larvae. The silk fiber is the protein fiber, which is composed of fibroin protein, which is secreted as a fibrinogen and converted to fibroin on the exposure, and the other one is sericin. The silk is measured as a denier, which is equivalent to the weight in grams of 900 meter long silk filament. In this presentation, we will only learn about the mulberry silkworm in details, which is divided into two parts. First is moriculture, that is cultivation of food plants, and the other is rearing of silkworm. For moriculture, first step is to choose a mulberry variety of Morus indica available for more leaves yield. It has various varieties like Kanwa 2, then Victory 1, etc. used in South India, then Bear S1 or S623 used in Eastern and Northern India, and Kosan, Botatul, KNG, etc. are used in hilly areas of Eastern and North India. For propagation of mulberry, seeds, root grafts or stem cutting methods are generally used. And for planting mulberry trees, two systems are in vogue, the pit and the row system. In the pit systems, pits 45 centimeter wide and 45 centimeter deep, with 90 centimeter and 45 centimeter distance between the rows and the plants, are dug prior to the monsoon. While in the row system, cuttings are planted, which are procured from the nurseries, on the margin of 60 by 30 centimeter ridge. The distance here between the rows and plants are 45 centimeter and 10 centimeter. Mulching, that is covering the soil between the mulberry rows with paddy straw or stubbles or dry leaves, and then pruning is also done repeatedly for proper growth of mulberry plants. Harvesting of leaves or for feeding larvae is done in three ways: leaf picking, branch cutting and top shoot harvesting. Moriculture also encounter diseases and pests of mulberry plant, which are listed here. There are many fungal diseases, that is the leaf spot, powdery mildew, then black leaf rust, red leaf rust, fungal leaf blight, bacterial leaf blight, wilt disease, white root rot, violet root rot, fusarium root rot, stem root, then collar root, cutting roots, stem canker, and there are some viral diseases like leaf mosaic, yellow net vein disease, then dwarf disease, which is caused by the mycoplasma, and there are some diseases also caused by nematodes. There are many serious pests causing defoliation and withering of the leaves. These are pink mealybugs, then mulberry leaf roller, leaf hopper jessets, then Bihar hairy caterpillar, scale insects, thrips, stem girdler, then beetle, short-horned grasshopper, spiraling white fly. Before moving forward to next part, that is rearing of silkworm, first let's get familiar with the distribution and life cycle of Bombyx mori. Bombyx mori have been supposed to be evolved from a wild ancestor, Bombyx mandarina, which is the native of China. So there is no wild variety of Bombyx mori. It can be domesticated under the optimum climatic conditions, that is 20 to 28 degrees Celsius temperature and 70 to 85% relative humidity, with 16 hours of photophase. These conditions are available in the states like Jammu and Kashmir, West Bengal, Karnataka, Andhra Pradesh and Tamil Nadu. After mating, adult female lays eggs in around 400 to 500 in a cluster. The egg undergoes diapause in temperate region. However, in subtropical region, non-diapause eggs are laid. In about 10 days, eggs hatch into larva called as ant or kego or chowky, which undergo 4 molts and thus have 5 instars. The larval period lasts for 25 days. The last instar stop eating and starts a spinning cocoon, which is completed in 48 to 72 hours. Then larva transforms into pupa within the cocoon, which lasts for 10 to 14 days. For rearing of silkworm, first step is to select its races, which are usually of 3 types: univoltine, bivoltine, and multivoltine. Bivoltine are the Nandi and Kashmir varieties, and multivoltine are Mysore and Nistari varieties, which are generally used. The culturing bivoltine races are profitable and generally used by the sericulturist. Then there is a selection of construction of the rearing house, which should meet the certain specifications needed, as silkworms are sensitive to weather conditions. Place selected for construction of the building should be sunny, dry, and as far as possible elevated. The orientation of rearing house can be of at the north or northwest face and southeast at the back. The length of the rearing room varies according to the brushing capacity. Various rearing equipment are required for proper rearing of silkworm, which are listed here. Rearing stand on which rearing trays containing silkworms are placed. Antlers are rectangular or circular enamel or concrete balls containing water with repellents, in which the legs of the rearing stand are kept to protect them from the ants. Rearing trays generally circular, made up of bamboo for rearing early instars, that is first and second instars. Paraffin paper sheets coated with paraffin wax or used to cover the rearing trays to maintain humidity and prevent weathering of the leaves. Foam rubber strips soaked in water are also kept around silkworm rearing beds to maintain humidity. Chopsticks are used to pick up younger stages of larvae to ensure their hygienic handling and preventing from injuries. Then feather, preferably white or white, which are important item of silkworm rearing room. They are used for brushing of newly hatched worms from the egg cards to rearing trays, or spreading larvae for proper spacing to prevent injury. A leaf basket made up of bamboo to collect and transport, and leaf chambers to store the leaves are also used. Then chopping board, knives and mat are also required to chop the mulberry leaves into small pieces, which are needed for feeding. Cleaning nets made up of cotton or nylon mesh are also used, so that the leftover leaf pieces and litter are filtered out without larvae being touched by hand. Then wet and dry thermometer, charcoal stove, room heater, water air cooler, then plastic box, bleaching powder, lime powder, slides and cover slips are also few more miscellaneous equipments needed during the rearing of silkworm. Mountages, or which are known as also known as cocoonages, are made up of rectangular bamboo, wood or cardboard, plastic, then dry leaves or twigs to support the penultimate or fifth instar larva for spinning the cocoon. There are many various types of the mountages generally used, that is bamboo chandraix, plastic mountages, then plastic collapsible mountages, screen type mountages, and bottle brush mountages, plastic bottle brush mountages, rotary mountages, vertical fix mountages, and shoot rearing rack. The larvae about to spin cocoon are transferred onto them, and the larvae suspend themselves to the mountages and spin cocoons. Use of quality silkworm eggs is the vital step to successful sericulture. Silkworm eggs are called as seeds, which are of two types, reproductive seed and commercial or industrial seed. Reproductive seeds are used for the production of parents of different commercial seeds and are pure breeds, whereas the commercial seeds are hybrids produced in mass for supply to sericulturist. Then seed production centers are breeding stations, breeding centers, and grainages where disease-free seeds of the pure and hybrid races are produced in large quantities and then provided to sericulturists. Before the commencement of rearing process, the rearing house equipment, etc., are disinfected first, either by physical or chemical methods. Then brushing method is used to separate the newly hatched larvae from the egg sheets or cards and to transfer onto the rearing trays with the help of the feathers. Then selection of leaves is also an important step for the growth of silkworms and quality of cocoon formation in the sericulture. Younger instar larva, that is first and second instar larva, are given tender succulent leaves with the high moisture content, whereas the older instar are fed with mature but soft leaves with lesser moisture content. Feed bed, which is a layer of chopped leaves, are spread on a tray or over a large area, is also prepared and changed time to time to avoid diseases or to maintain the hygienic conditions. Periodical removal of leaf leftovers and worm excreta through the bed cleaning is also done, and for this the cleaning mat net is used to avoid crowding, which lead to undernourishment and uneven development. Therefore, a proper spacing should also be maintained. Mounting with means, which means transferring a mature fifth instar larva to mountage or cocoonages to form the cocoons, can be done by hand picking branch method or net method. The care should be taken to select the right age and density of the larvae, which are put on the mountages to avoid overcrowding. Then the non-feeding fifth instar larvae come up and crawl onto the net or branches, which are then shaken on the mats, and the larvae are then transferred to the mountages. Then harvesting of cocoon is very crucial for the sericulturist, as early harvest of the cocoon could injure the pupa and results in their staining. On the other hand, late harvest leaves less time for transporting the cocoons to the market, as there is a risk of being cut by the emerging moths, which are rendered unfit for reeling. Therefore, care and choice of correct time of harvesting should be considered. After harvesting of cocoons, the industrial part of silk industry begins, that is post-harvest processing of cocoons, which includes stiffling or drying, which is done to kill the pupa. before they metamorphose into moth, and cocoon boiling, which is done to make the cocoon thread reliable by dissolving the gum like protecting sericin that bind the winding segments of the threads. Deflossing is also important to remove floss, that is loose layer of silk filament, before reeling. Silk reeling is the process of finding the right end of the cocoon filament and jointly taking several ends together to reel raw silk. The reeling method used are country charkha, then cottage basin, or filager. The next step is re-reeling, where the raw silk is first reeled on a small reels and allowed to properly dry up on them, and then re-reeled on large wheel. Whereas direct reeling on large reels leads to insufficient drying, which in turn leads to a production of hard gum spots on the thread. So it is not preferred. Raw silk testing is also done before marketing, for which there are Indian and international standards to judge the quality of the raw silk. To maintain these standards, raw silk is put to a number of tests, that is visual examination, winding test, then denier size and deviation test, seriplane test, and winding quality, neatness, evenness, or tenacity test. During the silk reeling, the products like pierced cocoons and silk waste are obtained. So these are utilized for producing silk yarn by the process of spinning. It involves drawing the loose lump of waste containing fibers or small staple length into slender slivers, where the fibers can lie in a more or less parallel manner and are then simultaneously twisted in spin yarn and wound on a wooden spindle. There are many problems related to sericulture, especially diseases and enemies of silkworm. The diseases are categorized into four categories, that is bacterial disease, protozoan disease, then viral and fungal diseases. Bacterial diseases include gastroenteric disease, septicemia, Sotto disease, Runge or coat disease, and Gattine disease or clear head disease. Protozoan disease is the pebrine disease, which is caused by Nosema bombiensis. Then the viral disease is caused by cytoplasmic polyhedrosis virus, that is Fletchery disease, and Grasserie disease, which is caused by the nuclear polyhedrosis virus. The fungal diseases include white muscardine, green, yellow, and black muscardine, and aspergillosis. There are many enemies which are of great threat to the sericulture, which includes dipteran fly, that is Uzi fly belonging to the family Tachinidae, Tricholiga bombiensis, and Coleopteran beetle, that is Dermestis or Anthrenus, which damage cocoons and sometimes eggs and larvae. India occupies a fifth position in the world in its silk production. The first four in the order of production being Japan, then China, South Korea, and USA. Sericulture industry in India also employs about 60 lakhs people, mostly tribals. The actual production of silk by India is given in the table during 2018 and 19 and 2019 to 20, and the export earnings during 2019-20 was around 1498 crores rupees, then Now I end the presentation with the list of major research centers, then substations and extension centers in India. Thank you.